Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning, they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Good afternoon, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Please sit as we shall now have a tribute followed by the eulogy.
Blessed good evening to everyone. If I walk in the pathway of duty, if I work till the close of the day, I shall see the great King in his beauty when I've gone the last mile of the way. When I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of the day, and I know there are joys that awaits me when I've gone the last mile of the way. If for Christ I proclaim the glad story, if I seek for his sheep gone astray, I shall see the great King in his beauty when I've gone the last mile of the way. When I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of the day. Here the dearest of time we must savor. Tears of sorrow are seen every day. But no sickness is no sign forever. When I've gone the last mile of the way, and if I have earnestly savored and have tried all my will to obey, 'twas all the rapture of heaven when I've gone the last mile of the way. And if I here have earnestly savored and have tried all my will to obey, 'twas all the rapture of heaven when I've gone the last mile of the way. When I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of day.
I know thought that no toys left await me when I go the last mile of the way.
Maureen was a friend of mine, an honest friend, and I believe this evening the tear I shed for the joy, the love, and the kindness that Maureen showed to me working with her. To her siblings, you had a wonderful sister. To her children, Alicia, Melissa, Mar, and Wayne, you had a loving, honest mother. May Maureen rest in peace, a very good friend.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. Maureen Veronica Gittens. Today we celebrate her life and thank God for the years that he had allowed her to be amongst us. Maureen, as she was familiarly called, was born in London, England on the 3rd of February 1958 and came to Barbados at a tender age, sometime in the 60s, with her parents, Whitfield and Ines Gittens, along with her younger brother, Neville Gittens. She was also sister of Lolita Pinder, and we know as Ori, Douglas Gittens, better known as Nigel, who resides in the United States, Margaret, we call Pat, Pauline, and Audrey, the mother of Wayne, Alicia, Melissa, and Mark Gittens. When Maureen was growing up, she was among sisters, brothers, cousins, and other relatives, a large number who gathered daily at the family house in Lemon Arbor. While among us, she was very quiet and reserved, and most times particularly shy. She was a tender case and always looked to her father or mother for calm protection. These characteristics would become Maureen's way of life. This quiet and shy woman would hardly be flustered, hardly raise her voice or engage in any situation that was confrontational. Therefore, this reserved lady lived a calm life. Alicia remembers her mother coming from her job at Bell Farm, who always had something to give, maybe fruits, toys, and would be happy and smile when she showed her gratitude. Alicia also said, "Mommy was not one to say I love you, but showed love to all her children, a love that was felt by every wrong around her with a smile that lift up a dull room." Mrs. said her mother was loving and selfless and showed much compassion. And being soft-spoken and peaceful, one might not have realized her presence. Mark also think she was quiet and always looked out for him. He recalled that sometimes when she shoved him off, he drew closer and hugged her. Then she could not resist that somebody for him. Maureen was grandmother of six: Alea, Alana, Afial, Sudan, Orzimar, Aiden, and Xavier. She was part of the operation of the bakery at Lemon Arbor, and after its closure, she was employed at Hill Milling at Haggett Hall, St. Michael. Maureen had close friends. Glendine Lovell, her neighbor. Irene Holligan, we just heard from Irene. And Audine Boxhill, those two worked with her at the bakery. And also Althea. She remained close friendship with Irene, whom I consider was her confidant. In her latest days of illness, her granddaughter Alia took the task to take care of her, and I believe Maureen was comfortable with her, thanks to Alia. While we mourn the loss of a sister, mother, aunt, a cousin, a relative, and friend, we may not understand what was on the line in this quiet and reserved loved one, but we can reflect on the following while we lovingly remember her. When we look at you, we always saw such peace. If you live with any pain, God granted you release. Any secrets that you live, we know that God forgive. When your faith seemed insecure, God's tender mercy did endure. So off to your final rest and claim your Savior. He knows best. May she rest in peace.
Please stand for the reception of the body. The Lord be with you. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our sister Maureen. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Through all the changing scenes of life, hymn 427. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please sit for the first Bible reading.
A Bible reading from the Word of Written in Lamentation 3, verses 22 to 26, 31 to 33. The steadfast of the Lord never ceases. His mercy comes to an end. There are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who want to wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord, for the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of the steadfast of love. For he does not willing affect or grieve anyone. The word of the Lord.
Amen. We shall remain seated for the singing of Psalm 46. Second Bible reading.
verse is taken from John chapter 14, 1, verse 1 to 6. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you that. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also, and you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where we are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The word of the Lord.
Please stand as we shall sing the hymn 223, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Oh, Now let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. The book of St. Matthew, chapter 7, the 13th and the 14th verses. Jesus has given some counsel to those of us here today as he gave back then. And it reads thus, "Enter ye in at the strait gate, for broad is the way, and that leadeth to destruction, and wide is the gate that leads there." Then he says, "Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." In essence, Jesus is saying that there are only two roads in life. One is broad and all-inclusive. The other is narrow. And if you were to read that text, you would see that that straight is not straight. It is straight, from a root word that means difficult. Jesus is saying to us, enter in at the difficult gate. Because the other gate is broad. It's wide. There are no limits, no boundaries. You can do anything there. You can live anyhow there. And sad to say, most of the world, the majority of people in the world, have chosen that broad gate. They don't want any limits. They don't want to be hedged in. They just want to live as they please. But there's wisdom in following what Jesus says. His counsel is, enter the straight gate. Because that straight gate, all those who choose that road will eventually have eternal life. You know, I'm glad that God made us with choice. We're not robots, we're not programmed. He made us with choice. That's why there's sin. That's why there's death. In the book of Genesis, you see God coming from eternity. As one writer says, stepping onto nothing and saying, let there be something. Started the creative process. All that you and I take now for granted were not non-existent. The earth was covered with water. There was nothing living. And God caused the waters, the rivers, the body of water to dress back into what is now seas and oceans and rivers and lakes. And the dry land appeared. And then spoke trees into existence. And these were not seedlings. As a matter of fact, the same day that God spoke them into existence, they were bearing fruit, laden with fruit, in abundance. That's the power of God. Made a perfect home for Adam. On the sixth day, God took some dirt. As I told some folk at the funeral this morning, at another place, that's what you and I were made from. Dirt. Dirt. Sometimes we behave as though we are made from gold, silver. You and I are made from dirt. And that's why when the minister goes to the graveside, he doesn't say gold to gold or silver to silver. He says earth to earth, ashes to ashes. That's where we came from. So God formed Adam, bundle of dust, and then he spoke into Adam's nostrils the breath of life. And Adam's eyes began to see. His ears heard. His hands moved. His feet walked. Because now you have the equation. Body of dust plus the breath of life equals living soul. That's what you are. That's what I am. You are just a bundle of dirt plus the breath of life. And one day that breath of life will depart us and we're going to end up just like Maureen, body of dust. But while we are alive, God says there's some choices that we have to make. One writer says it depends on the decisions that we make, that we will feast at the banquet of our consequences. A decision to serve Jesus, to live for God, will one day result in life that will never end. But since God made you with choice, you can choose not to serve him. You can do as you please. Every bashment, every party, whatever you desire to do, you do. But there are consequences. Sad to say, there are too many persons who live their lives and then hope that when they die, that somehow you can be put in heaven. That's not the minister's prerogative. You make that decision while you are alive. And I want to say to my friends, my family, perhaps some of them whom I'm getting to see for the first time and perhaps getting to see me, say, look, a life serving Jesus makes a whole lot of sense. And here are the dividends. The word of God says that one day life on this earth will come to a screeching halt. Jesus promised his disciples that. They had lived with him here while he was here on earth for 33 and a third years. And the time came when he had to go back to his father. And they, were sad. But Jesus said to them, St. John chapter 14 verses 1 to 3 that you know so well, let not your heart be what? Why? You believe in God? Believe also in me. Why? Because in my father's house are many mansions. There's one with your name there on it. There's one with my name on it. If it were not so, he said, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place. Jesus came and lived on this earth for 33 and a third years. He said foxes had holes and birds had nests, but the Son of Man didn't have a place to lay his head. Very often he hung out at Mary and Martha and Lazarus' home. He didn't have a place of his own, yet the world belonged to him. And finally they took him out of the way, nailed him to a cruel cross. Let's get rid of him. Put him in a borrowed grave. But the word of God says that the grave could not contain him. Friday, all day Saturday, Sunday morning, the grave held him captive. But early Sunday morning, the word of God says, when Mary and Martha went back to the tomb as they did on Friday evening, as they went there with the spices and the body and the ointments to embalm him, but the sun had already set, and the Sabbath was beginning, and they went home, the word of God says, and kept the Sabbath according to the commandment. But early Sunday morning, they came there with the same spices to embalm Jesus. But when they got there, what had happened? He had already risen. I'm glad today I serve a risen Savior. My Jesus is not dead. He was dead, but he's alive, and he'll be alive forevermore. And all those who make a commitment to serve him and to serve him in spirit and the truth with their whole heart, you have the assurance, my friends, that once you serve Jesus one day too, life eternal will be yours. We live in this world, and every time you turn on the news, it is proliferated with bad news. Sometimes you hear some little good news story at the end. Here the reporter says, and last of all, some little good news, but all the other items are war, shootings, bombings, earthquake, tornado, bad news. One day we'll live in a world where there'll only be good news. I want to live there, don't you? That will be a reality. So Jesus told his disciples, let not your heart be troubled. Why? You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place. I'm glad I serve a God that always keeps his word. Came forth triumphant from the grave. And one day while he was there in conversation with Peter and James and John and all the other disciples, all of a sudden, gravity lost its hold on him. He started going up. Up in Acts chapter 1, verse 9 to 11. He started going up. Not in a spacecraft made by Elon Musk or Richard Branson, but he was going up on plain air. And the word of God says that while he was going up, two angels stood by Peter and the others and said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye there gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus with the nail scars in his hands, this same Jesus that still bore the mark from the crown of thorns on his head, this same Jesus whose mark, the marks from the nails in his feet, this same Jesus that still had the marks from the sword that pierced his side, as you see him go up visibly and literally, one day he will come and the whole world will see him. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 16 says, for the Lord himself, he has gone to prepare that place. I often say to my congregation, it took my Jesus 6 literal days, Sunday to Friday, to create this whole world and everything in it. It's over 2,000 years now that he has gone to prepare that place. You think it will take my God 2,000 years to prepare a place? He can speak that into existence. But he's waiting for somebody here today. Somebody perhaps who have been saying for the longest while, one of these days I'm going to serve my God. One of these days I'm going to go to church. Or one of these I'm going to get back to church. And sometimes death steals up upon you and you don't even know. You come dead. I'm saying if you're going to come back to Jesus, or if you're going to come to him, you must walk in here. The moment 6 men or 6 people bring you in here, you come too late. Nobody can do anything for you then. So I say to every young person here today, every person here today who perhaps began the year or the end of the year, you are making these resolutions. When the new year start or going back to church, I hear got a young priest at St. John, he preaching good. I going to church there. I went back to this church or whatever. And the new year is almost half. And the only time you turn up is at a funeral. I'm saying, my brothers and sisters, make your calling and election sure. Very soon Jesus will say it is done. Just as he promised his disciples that he will go, he promised them that he will come. The word of God says in 1 Thessalonians, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. Yes, he ascended, and now he's going to come back down. He shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. It pains to serve the Lord. The word of God says when Jesus Christ comes again, not every dead man or dead woman will come up. First of all, the dead in Christ. And I'm saying if you're going to die in Christ, you must live for him. How many people feel that church, it seems as though that they have in this mind, in their minds, that some of you go to church, they got some terrorists at the door. But when there's a bashment, they ain't got none. Left to go one of my churches some couple weeks ago. And I literally parked. It took me an hour and a half to get from the bottom of Farley Hill to get it to the top. Well, seriously, don't fall. You know, okay, no. Seriously. When they got up there, really, that they had some reggae on the hill. Abashment. Many people can't find church clothes, but they can find bashment clothes. And bashment clothes, as a matter of fact, you know, are those clothes where, I mean, yeah, you're supposed to go on something, but you ain't going nothing. Because all kind of things popping up. And some of the things that popping up better look better closed up. I've seen better limbs on trees. Spend big money on bashment outfits, but can't find enough to buy an outfit to come into the house of the Lord. But one day, it'll be too late. You don't have much time, my friends. Your life is just like a vapor. Here today, gone today, not even tomorrow. If you were to die now, this very moment, is it well with your soul? Do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Is he the Lord of your life? This counsel is so important. He says, go in at the straight gate. Because the broad one that everybody has seen, though the whole world is on that. The end result is destruction. I say to you today, my friends, look, that Jesus that has promised, he's always kept his promises. Might have heard me say this before. But John, his beloved disciple, I'd like to end my sermons with this here. John, the beloved disciple that Jesus loved so much. Jesus loved John as much as a man can love another man and still be a man. So much so that when he was there dangling from the cross, he said to John, John, behold thy mother. Talking about his mother Mary. Mary, behold thy son. In actual fact, he said, John, I'm entrusting the care of my mother to you. Take care of her. John was the last surviving of the disciples. All the others had died some cruel deaths. John was put, as history says, John was put in a pot of oil to be fried, and the oil failed to make any impression upon his skin. And they took him out and put him on an island called Patmos. But while he was there on Patmos, that island in the Aegean Sea, Jesus came down on that island and gave John a privilege that perhaps no other human being has ever had. Jesus gave John the ability to pull back the curtain that separated from the present from the future. And John was able to look down to the end of the world, the end of time. And as John looked, John wrote, and John said, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for this first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea." And John kept looking down to the end of time, and he said, "And I saw new Jerusalem." He said, "It was not a figment of my imagination. It is real. I saw it with my own eyes. New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband." And telling you today, my brothers and sisters, heaven is real. And hell is real too. You, because of the decisions that you make, one day you will end up either or. Heaven or hell. My prayers that today, let this date, let the 23rd of May, be a significant day to you. My prayers that somebody would make their entrance into the kingdom. We may not cross paths again, but today, because of what you heard, you would make up your mind to serve God. Stop procrastinating, putting off. You don't have tomorrow put down. Tomorrow is guaranteed, but there's no guarantee that you will see it. The time that we have is now. Now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. Behold, today is the day of salvation. My prayers, brothers and sisters, that when the roll is called up yonder, that because of the decision that you've made, you've entered in at the straight gate, that when the roll is called up yonder, you would not have to be running to the rocks and to the mountains, but you'd be running to the Rock of Ages, singing Rock of Ages, "Cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee." May the Lord be with you. And I pray today that these words would fall upon good ground in your heart, and that when Jesus comes, it will be your lot to welcome him as he welcomes you and give to you life that will never end, is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Please stand as we now affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed, found on page 5 of your booklet. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
During the singing of this next hymn, there will be a collection for the upkeep of the church cemetery. Hymn 236, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
prayers this afternoon, your response to the bidding, Lord, in your mercy, will be hear our prayer. We pray for those who mourn, and we commemorate the departed. Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy, may we be strengthened in our faith, live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy, show your mercy to the dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy, we commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Father of all, we pray to you for Maureen and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. May she and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Let me take this opportunity to extend sincere condolences to you, the relatives and friends of our dear departed sister, and assure you of this church's prayerful support, and pray that you will continue to feel God's love and peace throughout your time of bereavement. We don't normally do this, but because of the weather, in the event that the rain comes down again, what we shall do is that we will have the committal as we exit the church, just at the back of the church, and then we shall move over to the graveyard. Please remain standing for the commendation.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant, with your saints.
Let your sorrow and pain are no more.
Let us sigh in, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind. And we are mortal, born of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Your sorrow and pain are no more, let it sigh, but life everlasting.
Let us commend our sister Maureen to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant, Maureen, O sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit, live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Maureen. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. To God be the glory, great things he has done. Hymn 387.
Glory, 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 glory.
Lord be with you. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. Ensure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. We commend to Almighty God our sister Maureen, and we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, our sister Maureen and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died, in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, raise us, we humbly pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, and at the resurrection, receive that blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our mediator and redeemer. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Yeah.
When peace like a river attendeth my way.
Oh,
when the roll is called up yonder. When we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all sing and shout the victory.
Basil. That's it.
Let us pray. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious to her. The Lord lift up his countenance upon her and give her peace. And unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. May she and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.